What's going on, guys? My name is Sankas, and I just want to apologize beforehand if I sound a little strange in this video because I'm starting to get a little sick, so I'm going to sound more nasally than usual, but I still want to get you guys some tutorials, so I'm going to do my best here and try not to sound too awful. But anyways, in this video, we're going to talk about some frequency splitting. The purpose of frequency splitting in sound design is usually to be able to affect and process or modulate different frequency ranges separately and isolate those frequency ranges from others and get nice little combinations of processing to all the frequency bands which you've created. So for example, if we were to make a quick little respace for this example with Serum, I'm just gonna bring this down 2 octaves, detune it with 16 voices and distort it a bit, and insert some mono legato with some portamento time so we get this very kind of basic bass. So let's just create a MIDI clip for this. Very basic kind of thing here. I'm just gonna insert that. So if we have this bass here and we wanna modulate this bass or post-process this bass and add some effects to it, then we can frequency split it. We can split it into certain frequency groups. We can split it into more than one frequency group, or more than two or three, of course. We can choose as many as we want, and therefore we can keep the sub clean. We can modulate the or process the mid-range, the mid frequencies differently from the high end, and we could even widen out the high end separately or distort the high end, saturate the high end differently from the mid-range bands. So to start off, I'm gonna go ahead and just name this bass because that will make things a lot easier in the process, and I definitely recommend that you do this because the more frequencies you split your bass into, the more channels you're gonna have, and it definitely helps to name things and, you know, keep up with that in order to have a cleaner workplace. So I'm just gonna name this bass. So I've named this input. I'm going to send it to channel 41 by just having this selected here, going to channel 41 and using Control L to send it in. So to start off, I'm going to go ahead and right click this channel next to it, channel 42, and select route to this track only. So we'll route to channel 42 and get rid of the routing to the master. We only want it to go into these next few channels here without going into the master. So we're gonna also click the next two channels next to it. Just click them like this and make sure that it's not going into the master. I'm just gonna name these. I'm gonna name this low, mid, and high, make it easier to see. And of course, all of these here are just going to be going straight into the master. So what we'll do is we'll take channel 45 and name that the bass output, which is the channel that the low, mid, and high will output into. And then we'll go to low, mid, and high channels, and we'll just do the same thing. We'll right-click it and route to this track only. We'll do the same thing for all of them so it doesn't go into the master. Note how when I do this, the routing to the master disappears, which is what we want. So now we have the bass going into the low, mid, and high channel, which are all going to the bass outputs. Now the sound is going to be a whole lot louder because it's basically just stacking the sound since we haven't split the frequencies yet. There's a few different ways to do this. One way is by using an EQ and just creating bands and band passes, sort of, and creating several different ones for your channels. We'll use that in the second method, which I'll demonstrate here, but for this method we'll use the Maximus. I'm just gonna load up 3 Maximus on all of these. Now of course, if you leave it like this, you're gonna have just the same thing. So we're gonna have to go to our Maximus and we can look at our bands here. We can change our bands with these knobs, of course. We can take the narrow down the low band and create a bigger mid band, or we can take down the high band and create a narrower mid band and a bigger high band, and vice versa. We can hone on in on these. Excuse me, and when we're doing this for the other ones, if we change these, of course, we can copy the value and insert it into the next maximus to have, consistency across all three maximus. I'm just going to reset them and leave them at its default state to make it easier. And since we're on our low band, I'll go to the low banded maximus. I'm going to turn the compression off because I don't want to have any compression going here. I'm just going to solo this band. I'll go to the mid band, go to my mid band in here, turn up the compression, solo this band, go to my high band, and same thing, high band, compression off, and solo. So now if we turn off the mid and high band, we get just the low band playing. If we turn off the low and engage the mid, we get just the mid. And of course, same for the high band. So now we already have a pretty decent setup to process and insert effects and modulate these different bands differently from each other. So if you wanted to keep the sub bass nice and clean, we could do that. And if you wanted to distort the mid band a little bit differently from the high band, then we can also do that. So this is cool because you can insert all kinds of different effects without affecting the lower bands, and you can create some nice layers and some nice textures like that. And of course this allows you to mix your bands and your frequencies differently. So if you have too much mid, you can just take down the mid, and same for the mid, the highs and the lows. So it's nice because, again, as I said, we're not affecting the sub, we're not affecting the crispy high end, we can just do all this crazy stuff and we don't affect the rest. So it's definitely a very cool way to set up some sound design, and especially if you have projects like me that are dedicated to just your sound design, then it's cool to do this a couple times and get some nice clean sounds out of that. So of course there's another way of doing this. I'm gonna go ahead and send this into another channel so we can set up a different way of frequency splitting. So we have this just going into channel 50 again. It's not being frequency split. So what we can do is we can do this all inside of Patcher as well. I'm sure some of you have seen this done before, but for those of you who haven't, the thing that Patcher has as an advantage is that it keeps everything nice and clean in one patch, and you could save and load that patch into a project very easily, whereas compared to this, you would have to save these individually by going down to File and then saving the mixer track state, and then you'd have to do this about 5 times, and you'd have to save your own patch as well inside the Serum or whatever you're using. The advantage of Patcher is that, let's just go ahead and load it up here if I can find it. Pretty sure I have it in here. Here it is. The advantage of Patcher is that all the splitting will happen inside of this right here. So you have from FL Studio and then to FL Studio, and everything between here can be your frequency splitting. So if we just add a plugin from our generators. Alright, so I've dragged Serum into this patcher now, so we can create the same patch as we had earlier, just bring this down 2 octaves, detune this a bit, and add some distortion to it, so we get the same kind of sound as we had before. So I'll do the same thing. I'm just going to use the same MIDI that we have for this clip over here for the previous example. So back into the patcher, if we remove the connection from Serum to FL Studio, we can load up, as we did before, three different Maximus, but since we already did that for the previous example, this way it would be pretty much the same. We're going to use the parametric EQ method, so we'll go to effects, open the plugin picker, and we'll insert three parametric EQs. So now we have these three EQs here, and we're just going to send Serum to all three of them. And again, this is basically like the routing we did in a mixer, just a bit more visual and a little bit easier to see. And then we'll send these three EQs. We can either send them directly to an FL Studio, or we can send them to another compressor or another effects. We're going to actually send them into a compressor for this example. Going to use a Fruity limiter for this, so they'll all come together at the Fruity limiter. And then the Fruity limiter sends it back out to FL Studio. So again, we have, as with earlier, just the sound being pretty much stacked three times and being sent to the limiter. So now we need to set up our EQ bands. An easy way to do that is by clicking this arrow here once. And you get this nice little thing here, which is very good for creating your own bands. So I'm going to bring this one all the way down. And this high band I'll bring to around 200 is where I'll keep it. And I'll copy this value. Go into my second EQ. Same thing. And I'm just going to bring this band. Paste the value from the previous band into this bottom band. And choose a range for this one. I'll bring this to around 2000, 2047 is a good number, and I'll copy this. Last EQ, same thing. Oops, that was the wrong way. Now I'm just gonna copy that value onto this frequency over here. So now we have it split three times with these bands. So if we remove or mute any of these inputs, we get just one frequency range. If we've removed the low and the highs, so now we get just the mids. So that's a cool way of frequency splitting. Of course, to be able to modulate these different frequencies, you can add all kinds of different plugins. So if you wanted to keep the sub bass again nice and clean, we can just route that straight to the limiter. If we want to add some flanges to the mids, we can do that by just throwing it on the mid band. If we want to distort the highs, we can insert a fast distortion and just distort the highs and keep the other stuff nice and clean. So definitely a cool way to do sound design, and if you have the right ideas and the right processes, you can come up with some really, really cool stuff with this kind of process. So this can apply to any kind of sound. You can apply this to synths. That doesn't just have to be bass. This can be done with all kinds of different sounds in order to get some different processes and, you know, a different kind of overall quality out of your sound than just processing all the frequencies at once. So of course, some things I want to mention before I close out this video is that some plugins cause a delay. So if you use a very a plugin like, let's say, Ozone for example, or even EQ, parametric EQ itself already gives a little bit of a delay, stacking frequencies with or splitting these frequencies with plugins that cause more of a delay will start to kind of mess up your sound. This is hard for me to explain, but if you insert one plugin into one of these bands and you don't insert it into these other ones, this one band will all of a sudden have a delay, and somewhere down the road that could cause phasing issues for you. So if you are using a plugin that you know causes delay, you can make sure you use that plugin on the rest of your bands as well. You don't have to use the effect in the plugin. Just having the plugin on the band itself, sometimes not even doing anything or affecting the band, will be enough to compensate for that short delay or that latency that the plugin is creating, and hopefully help you avoid phasing issues later on down the road. And this is especially important for layering up sounds without splitting them. If you're layering the same sound over and over with different plugins and you hear phasing, then that could be because your phases are not aligned and therefore are not stacking. Your phases are in fact phasing. So I hope this gave people some ideas. I hope this gave you some ideas and makes you think at sound design and processing sounds in a different way. And with that being said, thanks for watching. You guys have a good one.